So here we are, the launch of a brand new series called Rebel. What's a rebel? A rebel is someone who rises up in opposition against the establishment. And so depending on your generation, your frame of reference, everybody, when you hear the word rebel, you think of somebody specific. Maybe you think of James Dean, who was a rebel without a cause. How do you remember James Dean when that was brand new? Yeah, I was actually reading an article that James Dean is still one of the top grossing deceased entertainers because there's a clothing company that uses James Dean and the rebel without a cause thing as their primary thing. So for some of you, you think of James Dean. Maybe for others of you, because you're a child of the 80s, when you hear about a rebel, you just think of Billy Idol's The Rebel Yell. That's a good song, right? Classic song. Maybe you think about William Wallace, made popular by the movie Braveheart. Maybe you think about Morpheus and Neo and Trinity from the Matrix movies, rebelling against the Matrix. Or if you're a younger folk, maybe you think about Katniss Everdeen. Yeah, oh, I was like, oh, yeah. They're like, yeah, we know who that is. A rebel is somebody who rises in opposition against the establishment. Now, a rebel could be either good or evil, depending on the circumstances, obviously. Not all rebels have noble causes, and almost all the ones that I listed, except for maybe James Dean, of course, had a noble rebellion. But when you think about the word rebel and you think about the Bible, if I were to say, name me one biblical character who acts as a rebel, almost everyone would get the book that we're going to start. And that's Jonah, the quintessential rebel. So I want you to open up in your Bibles to Jonah chapter 1. Now, if you're here, I want to get you to the book of Jonah. If you didn't bring a Bible, there's Bibles in the pews in front of you. I want you to be able to read along. If you're part of our online audience, we want you to pull up the book of Jonah or open an actual Bible. Jonah is in the very last section of your Old Testament, which we call the minor prophets. Now, we call them the minor prophets because they are less verbose than the major prophets. So I'm here to tell you that there's no prophet who's minor. They just didn't say as much as the major prophets. So the major prophets, of course, are Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and Daniel. And I can't figure out how my name ended up in the verbose prophets, but I don't know. Anyway, then you have the next section is what we call the minor prophets. They're shorter books. You have Hosea, Joel, Amos, Obadiah, amen, that's my boy's name. And then the book of Jonah. So Jonah sits between Obadiah and Micah in that very last section of your Old Testament. So if you get to Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, you just got to turn to your left just a few books, and there's the book of Jonah. Now, because we're going to be taking a chapter, a study for the next 4 weeks in the book of Jonah, I do want to give you some homework. Because if you look at Jonah, if you're there at Jonah chapter 1, you realize that this book is, in my Bible, it covers 2.5 pages. And so what I want to encourage you to do over the next month or so, as I want you to read the book of Jonah every single day. I want you to get the book of Jonah deep into your heart. Because what I want to tell you is this, is that we called the series Rebel really not because Jonah's the rebel. There's lots of rebels in the story. But you know who the big rebel, the main character of the book of Jonah is? It's God. God is the one who rises up in opposition to the establishment. You may never have thought about it that way. Think about what's going to go on in this story. God is sending Jonah to the arch enemies of the children of Israel, the city of Nineveh and the Assyrians. And Jonah knows that God, in sending him there, is giving them an opportunity to change their ways and be forgiven. And so Jonah takes off in the other direction. See, for every single human being exacting justified revenge on an enemy is just what ought to happen. But God doesn't function that way. God is the rebel of the story. Everything about this story shows that God does things differently than the prophet Jonah would do it, any other government would do it. God's different. God's the rebel of this story. And we're going to see that over the next four or so studies. But I want you to really spend some time getting into the book of Jonah, making it part of who you are. Because we all find ourselves, in a lot of ways, in the position that Jonah's in. So let's jump right on in. Jonah chapter 1, verse 1. It says, "Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying, 'Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry out against it, for their wickedness has come up before me.' But Jonah arose to flee to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. He went down to Joppa and found a ship going to Tarshish, for he paid the fare and went down into it to go with them to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord." Now, this is the introduction and sets the stage for the book. And I'm going to pull the point out of verse 3, and then I'm going to back up and give you some of the foundation. But notice what it says in verse 3. "But Jonah arose to flee to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord." And then at the end it says, "to go with them to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord." Now, the lesson for us is that you can't run from God. You can't run from God. See, Jonah is trying to run away from God. Now, you might say, okay, well, listen, you know, Pastor, man, we're in church, man. I mean, doesn't that prove that, like, we're not running from God? Our Bibles have all sorts of information about people who know God and who are running from him. Think about Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. Do you remember those two? After they ate of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and they had a fig leaf clothing line to cover up their nakedness, they heard God, and what did they do? They hid. All through the Bible, you find people hiding. And the truth for us is that you can't hide from a God who is everywhere. But many of us are trying to. Many of us in this room right now, you believe in God, but you're trying to hide from him. Jonah, who ought to have known better, a prophet of the Lord, he runs, trying to run from the presence of the Lord. It reminds me of a song from that great Jamaican theologian, Bob Marley. He's saying, "You keep running and running and running, but you can't run away from yourself." Isn't that the truth? That's a very true statement. You can keep running and running, but you can't run away from yourself. Why? Because you were created in the image and likeness of God. You're always with you, and God is always with you. So I wanted to put this out there at the very front, because I know that there are many of you right now in your own walks with Jesus, you're running from him. And I want to save you from being on a fool's errand. Because you can't run away from a God who is everywhere. And if you're here and you've put your faith and trust in Jesus already, the Spirit of God dwells within you, which means if you can't run away from yourself, you can't run away from God because God's in you. So stop running and return. But Jonah, he is acting the way all of us have a tendency to act. Look at what happens. It starts in verse 1. "Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah." Now that phrase, "the word of the Lord came to somebody," it always introduces a divine communication to a prophet. And you find that over 100 times in the Old Testament. So this is a very common phrase in the Hebrew language, which literally says God is speaking to a prophet. So this is, all of this is instigated by God. God comes to this prophet. Now, we find out his name is Jonah, the son of Amittai. Now, you will find the name Jonah, the son of Amittai, outside of your Bible in one other place, and that's in 2 Kings chapter 14, verse 25. 2 Kings 14, 25. In that passage, so if you like taking notes, you can write that down, 2 Kings 14, 25. If you like to little references, it's in my reference Bible there. What we learn about Jonah, the son of Amittai, first is that he was active during the reign of King Jeroboam II. Now, I'm going to explain to you why this is important, because I know all of you have all the kings of Israel memorized, right? Yeah, that's right. Look, I was like, oh, yeah. I don't have them memorized either, so don't worry. But read about them. Read about them. His reign was at about 782, 781 before Christ to about 753. So 8th century. Now, why is this important? Because if you either paid attention during world history when you're in high school, and I already know the answer to that one, or if you studied your Bible at any length, you find that the Bible has three instances where the children of Israel are displaced off of their land. There's two in the Old Testament, and there's one in the New Testament. The two in the Old Testament, remember, the 12 tribes after David and Solomon ended up splitting. The 10 northern tribes became known as Israel. The two southern tribes became known as Judah, right? The 10 northern tribes went into exile to the Assyrians in about 722 BC, thereabouts. So 722, right? The two southern tribes, Judah, went into Babylonian exile in about 586, 587. So the 6th century. And Jeremiah and Daniel and all that is related to them. And then those are the two Old Testament exiles. And then the New Testament exile, of course, is in the book of Acts after Jesus has died and is resurrected. And the Romans come and they besiege Jerusalem and they destroy Jerusalem. And there's the dispersion of the children of Israel to the outer edges of the globe. Right? So we have three of them. Now, the reason this timestamp is important is we find that Jonah is a prophet in 780 to 760. So this is about 50 years before the 10 northern tribes go into exile to the Assyrian Empire. So this is before that. Now, before they went into exile, the Assyrians treated the children of Israel horrifically. To Jonah, Nineveh, the great city, one of the premier cities of the Assyrian Empire, would be the equivalent, the Assyrians would be the equivalent for us today of ISIS, right where we're living. They were absolutely brutal to the children of Israel. They were so brutal that if you fast forward to the New Testament, because the Assyrians were so brutal that the 10 northern tribes, they literally ethnically cleansed it and they became known as the Samaritans. And if you know your New Testament, you know that the children of Israel didn't walk through Samaria. Jesus meeting that woman at the well in John chapter 4, it was strange that he would walk through it. Remember the Good Samaritan? And we've taught that here, where we've told you that when you use a Samaritan in Jesus' day, that was the most hated group of people because they were half-bloods. The Assyrians came in and ethnically cleansed the 10 northern tribes. And so the word of the Lord comes to this prophet Jonah about 50 years before the 10 northern tribes are conquered, right? We also learn that Jonah was from an area called Gath Hepher, which is in the tribe of Zebulun. Now, what's interesting about where he's from is it was about 3 miles northeast of Nazareth. So Jonah is from the north, from the Sea of Galilee regions, just about 3 miles north of where Jesus was raised. So we find that Jonah is a prophet in the northern kingdoms before the exile. And then we find out that the word of the Lord comes to Jonah and arise and go to Nineveh, that great city, verse 2, and cry out against it, for their wickedness has come up before me. Now think about this. The word of the Lord comes to Jonah, right? And this is the most hated group of people. They've been struggling with the Assyrians for a long time. And the Lord comes to him and says, listen, I want you to go to Nineveh, that great city. And you can read about Nineveh as early as Genesis chapter 10, right after the flood. Nineveh is a city. And it became a great and mighty city. It was one of the premier towns in Assyria in that in that empire. And he says, I want you to go to them and I want you to cry out against it and let them know that their wickedness has come before me. Now, if you put it into our context, this would be like God coming to one of us and saying, I want you to go and speak to the ISIS rebels, and I want you to tell them that God's judgment is coming. Now, you'd like to do that, but by video, right? Like, everyone would be like, man, what you guys are doing is coming before the Almighty God, and it is time to pay the piper. That's the message. The message is what you have sown, now it's time to reap. And that is a biblical principle, isn't it? Whatever it is that you invest, that's what you're going to get out. And if you invest in wickedness, you're going to get wickedness out the other end. Whatever you put in comes out. And that's an important principle for us, because in the entitlement of the generation that we all are living in right now, no matter if you're older or younger, we have this skewed idea that I can put in whatever I want and I can only get out what I want, which just, that's not real. And that's why for many of us, our lives are so challenging, because you think you can put in being mean to everybody and then everyone's going to like you on the other side. It just doesn't work that way. You can put in no work at your job and expect to get promoted. It just doesn't work that way. It really doesn't work that way. But whatever you sow, that you'll reap. And this message to the Ninevites is that, listen, all of your wickedness has come up before the Lord, and now it's time to pay for the wickedness. Now, you would think that a prophet of the Lord who's been his entire life, most likely, he's been under the oppression of the Assyrians. You would think Jonah would be excited about this, right? Like, all right, God's going to wipe the Assyrians out. But what happens? Verse 3. But, you see, notice that but, right? But Jonah arose to flee to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. He went down to Joppa and found a ship going to Tarshish, so he paid the fare and went down into it to go with them to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. Now listen, Nineveh was to the east of Israel, and Tarshish was as far as you can get north and west of it. Jonah went in the exact opposite direction. Why? Because, as you're going to find by the time you get to the end of the book of Jonah, Jonah knew that God declaring wickedness and judgment to the Ninevites, that God was going to give them an opportunity to change their ways and be forgiven. And Jonah was not having it. See, Jonah's sense of patriotic duty pushed over his sense of religious obligation. He did not want to be the prophet who went to the Ninevites and they repented and God thwarted his judgment, because he really wanted judgment. So Jonah tries to run. Twice in one verse, to flee the presence of the Lord, to flee the presence of the Lord, to flee the presence of the Lord. Jonah does not want God's calling on his life to be what it is. And you know what? It's easy to look at Jonah and be like, I can't believe he's like that, except for the fact that we're all like that a little bit. How many of you right now, God has called you to something and you are playing Jonah? You are running. You're going in the exact opposite direction. You're saying, no, Lord. How many? Listen, you can't run from God. I mean, look, you can't run from Usain Bolt, and he's a fast runner. You definitely can't run from the Almighty God. He's already beat you there when you get there. He's already where you're going to. And you can't run from him. In Psalm 139, verses 7 to 10, psalmist gets it. Where can I go from your spirit? Or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend into heaven, you are there. And if I make my bed in hell, behold, you are there. If I take the winds of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me and your right hand shall hold me. Theologically, we call this God's omnipresence, that God is always everywhere. The psalmist gets it, but Jonah thinks he can flee from the presence of the Lord. And many of us think the same thing, that we can flee. Now, it's interesting. He goes to Joppa, which is, it's present day just next to Tel Aviv. It's right on the Mediterranean Sea. If you've never been to the Holy Land, we're actually planning a trip. You'll hear about that in a couple weeks here at Crossroads for 2015. I'll be leading a tour in the Holy Land. We'll have some spots open for people if you want to go. But it's funny, Lynn and I, we visited there when Obadiah was just a little kid, and it was amazing because we ended up at Jaffa, and sure enough, we end up in the middle of a storm there. So if you know the story, he's gonna run into a big storm on the sea there, and it was both fun because all the electricity went out in the hotel we were in, and I got really nervous because I'm like, maybe I'm doing something wrong. But it ended up being a delightful moment in our trip for us as a family. With Obadiah was just little, and it was a great time. But he heads to Joppa, which is a port town on the Mediterranean, and he grabs a ship going to Tarshish. Now look at what happens next in verse 4. But the Lord sent out a great wind on the sea, and there was a mighty tempest on the sea, so that the ship was about to be broken up. Then the mariners were afraid, and every man cried out to his God and threw the cargo that was in the ship into the sea to lighten the load. But Jonah had gone down into the lowest parts of the ship, had lain down, and was fast asleep. Verse 6. So the captain came to him and said to him, "What do you mean, sleeper? Arise, call on your God. Perhaps your God will consider us so that we may not perish." And they said to one another, "Come, let's cast lots that we may know for whose cause this trouble has come upon us." So they cast lots, and the lot fell on Jonah. Then they said to him, "Please tell us, for whose cause is this trouble upon us? What is your occupation? And where do you come from? And what is your country? And of what people are you?" In verse 9, "And he said to them, 'I am a Hebrew, and I fear the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land.'" So you see what goes on. Jonah, fleeing from God's presence, jumps the ship in Joppa, heading in the exact opposite direction of where God has called him. And it says in verse 4, "But the Lord sent out a great wind on the sea, and there was a mighty tempest on the sea, and the ship was about to be broken up." It's amazing. Often in the New Testament, you think about Jesus calming the storm, right, on the Sea of Galilee. But not only can God calm the storm, sometimes God stirs the storm up as well. Now notice, because Jonah's trying to run from God, and that's a fool's errand, now we find that Jonah's rebellion is impacting these other people. And this is the principle for us, that your rebellion impacts others. Your rebellion impacts other people. Why? Because none of us live in a vacuum. We live in a day and age where it says, "My life is my own. Who are you to tell me what I can do with my life?" It's like, no, we all inhabit this earth together. We're all neighbors in that way. And you have families, and you have coworkers, and you have classmates. And when somebody does something that is in rebellion against God, that impacts other people. None of us are isolated in such a way that what you do doesn't impact everything else. And that is a very important principle. Jonah's rebellion against God, not fulfilling the calling of God on his life, is now having dire consequences on a group of people. Because he's on this boat, heading in the wrong direction. He paid the fare, he got on the boat, and now there is a mighty tempest on the sea, and the ship was about to be broken up. And then it says, "Then the mariners were afraid." Now, I want a little view into the life of a public speaker, how words are important and how in different contexts, word means different things. Now here, my translation uses the word mariners, but I can't really use the word mariners with you guys, because when I say mariners, you guys all think Seattle Mariners. And then the fact that I'm a New York Yankee fan and your only shot at winning a World Series in the last 20 years was thwarted by my Yankees, I know we got some problems there. So I can't use mariners. Then the next best word to use is sailors. But when you think of a sailor, you either think of somebody in the U.S. Navy, which is the wrong picture, or you think about somebody who makes a lot of money who goes sailing, which is the wrong picture. And then looking for the right word last night, I chose the word seaman, you guys gotta pray for me. It's very challenging. Because last night, I wasn't thinking. I just said, semen, and everyone started to giggle. And I said, S-E-A, man, thank you. But this is my life. And so I'm going to go with boat dudes. Okay? Is that good? Are we okay with that? Praise God. Because I figure I was going to use sea people because I want to be gender neutral, but that sounds like a bad horror movie. I mean, I was stuck. I prayed about this last night. I had a moment. So I'm going with boat dudes. Is everyone okay with that? Because boat dudes has all the right implication. They're dudes on a boat. There was no boat women then. So they're just dudes on a boat. They weren't fishermen. They were just dudes on a boat. Everyone good with that? Okay, if you want, don't cross it out in your Bible because this is not inspired. This is just me trying to navigate all of my issues. Okay? So dudes on a boat. Notice, when the dudes on the boat were afraid, it says, and every man cried out to his God, and they threw the cargo that was on the ship into the sea, verse 5, to lighten the load. So you see what's going on here now. You got these dudes on the boat. They're freaked out. They're not supposed to get this type or this kind of storm. It just wasn't that time. And so you have this dude on the boat, right? And they're freaking out by what's going on, right? And all of a sudden, they start to all cry out to their gods. And they do everything within their power to fix the situation by throwing all the cargo over, because according to the way things worked, people, when you're in a horrible storm and you're worried that your boat is going to break, you need to lighten it up so the boat will be more nimble on the waves. So anything that's weighing it down is taken care of. So notice, they do everything spiritually they can do. They all believed in different gods. Polytheistic culture. Everybody believed. So everyone calls to their gods and they lightened their load. They did everything practically and spiritually they knew how to do. But notice what it says in the middle of verse 5. But Jonah had gone down into the lowest parts of the ship, had lain down, and was fast asleep. Now, why is Jonah sleeping? You know what the answer is? We don't really know. A lot of scholars say a lot of different things. Some people say that for the average boat dude, them being used to a storm, they would be more used to it, but the average kind of landlocked kind of a guy, it was all too much, so he's just like passed out from overstimulation. Some of our kids do that, right? Don't you wish you were a kid again? When it gets too loud, all of a sudden the baby just conks out, right? It's like, you know, I have a baby. I miss that. I just want to be in a little snuggly with my wife, sleeping when all the commotion's going on. But it could be that. It could be the fact that Jonah was so content with his decision that he was sleeping like a baby. But listen, there is, I believe, a lesson for you and I, isn't there? Because so many people who do not know God are being thrown about on the sea of life. Well, many of us, they're praying to a God isn't even real, and the people of God are sleeping in the bottom of the boat. Couldn't that be some of us right now? That you have loved ones, friends, neighbors. Life is tossing them about. And they're all crying out to whoever they understand God to be, crying out to the universe, crying out to good intentions and the law of attraction and all this stuff that our culture gives them. And the people of God are sleeping on a very soft pillow that is our finished salvation in Jesus. Don't get me wrong. Our salvation is a soft pillow. The finished work of Jesus is the ultimate place to lay your head. But we shouldn't allow God's extravagant grace to make us lazy. Don't allow God's extravagant grace to make you lazy. We need to be people who are praying. They're all crying out, but Jonah's sleeping. And in verse 6, so the captain came to him and said to him, what do you mean, sleeper? Now, I need to say this. Don't quote this verse to your lazy spouse. You can imagine someone sleeping. All of a sudden, the spouse goes, what do you mean, sleeper? That's from Jonah. Pastor Daniel taught it to us. He wakes, the captain's angry. What do you mean, sleeper? And then he says, arise, call on your God. Perhaps your God will consider us that we may not perish. I mean, think about the irony of this. Think about this. The captain of the boat who doesn't know the true and living God is going to the prophet who knows the living God, and that God is speaking to him and says, listen, you got to wake up and pray, bro. Maybe your God will deliver us. I mean, isn't that ironic? Isn't that terrifying? Because for some of us, you haven't prayed in a long time, and then somebody who you know doesn't believe in Jesus comes and say, hey, can you pray for me? I got all this junk going on. Like, we're being encouraged to pray by people who don't know that we can pray at any time because we're not praying. I mean, the irony of this is amazing. All the people who don't know God are praying, and the one guy who does know God on that whole ship is sleeping and getting woken up like, bro, can you pray, please? It's an amazing thing. Notice what happens. In verse 7, because things are getting worse, it says, and they said to one another, come, let us cast lots that we may know for whose cause this trouble has come upon us. So they cast lots, and the lot fell on Jonah. Verse 7, so they said, please tell us, for whose cause is this trouble upon us? What is your occupation, and where do you come from? What is your country, and of what people are you? See, these dudes on the boat dudes, right? They realize that this storm is not normal. Everything they're doing, it's not supposed to be happening. They can't get any relief. They're all crying out to their God, saying, hey, listen, God, if you're the God of the sea, can you help us? And all this stuff. Jonah gets up and finally, look, something's wrong here. Somebody did this to us. So they decided to cast lots, right? Now listen, I do not recommend casting lots to make decisions. But you find it often enough in our Bibles. The early disciples replaced Judas, who had just committed suicide, through the casting of lots, and the lot fell to a man named Matthias. In this case, they cast lots, and who does the lot land on? Jonah. And then they start peppering him with questions. Hey, who are you? Where are you from? What did you do? All that stuff. And notice how Jonah answers them. Verse 9. Jonah answers them by saying, I am a Hebrew, and I fear the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land. Now notice this. He says, I am a Hebrew. Tells him where he's from. I fear the Lord, the God of the creation who made the sea and the dry land. Now you notice this. Jonah fears the Lord, but he's actually not acting like it. Because if Jonah really feared the Lord, he wouldn't be running. And I think it's a challenging statement because I can respect Jonah for owning it. This is me. He didn't say, look, it's not me. He said, no, this is me. I'm doing this. I did this. It's my rebellion. My God is the God who created everything and the sea. This is all because of my God, and it's my fault. I fear the Lord. Now listen, many of you right now, you believe in God, you fear the Lord, but you're actually not living like it. I always say that fearing the Lord, it involves two aspects. One is authority, and the other is relationship, right? We should fear God's authority as the one who can not only take a life, but also eternally judge either to hell or to heaven in the afterlife. People don't like that about God, but God is that authority. I always use the same example about fearing authority because we all implicitly know how to do that. Why? Because if you're driving in your car, right? And all of a sudden you look in the rearview mirror and there is a car that's black and white and it's got lights on it. What do you do? You hit your brake, 10 and 2, right? Rearview mirror, speedometer. Rearview mirror, speedometer, right? Why do we all do, everybody does that, why? Because we all fear the authority of that police officer to pull us over and to issue us a citation. That's a natural human response. We just had it at Harvest Jam. I'm leaving with my kids, and sure enough, Officer Holly from VPD, Vancouver Police Department, she's there with her squad car. And I walk on out, look over, I see the cop car, and I automatically pick up the phone, and I call Ron Barron, our ops guy. I say, hey, there's VPD on the scene, is everything okay? And she's like, oh, he's like, oh yeah, it's just Officer Holly, she showed up so the kids can see the car and everything, and sure enough, I shuffled my kids over there, and I stuck my kids in the back seat, and I took pictures. Because that's the way that I roll, you know? It's like when some boy comes to ask for to take Maranatha out, I'm going to show him the picture of her in the back of the squad car. I'm going to say, absolutely not. You don't want to be dating a felon, do you? And I'll scare him away. But that's the kind of dad I am, you know what I mean? I want that shot. Obadiah with his hands on the bars, you know? It's awesome. But listen, I saw VPD in our parking lot and I automatically got nervous. Not because I thought we were doing anything wrong, but are we in violation of a fire code? You know, you start running through all these things in your head and you realize that they're there for a reason. And we all do it. And if you're going to fear a cop who can pull you over and give you a ticket, and that's a normal, natural human response, how much more should we fear the true and living God who has control over everything, including our destinies? So we fear God's authority, but we should also fear God in a relationship, because true loving relationships, you should fear to break somebody's heart. Like as a husband, I literally fear breaking Lynn's heart. I love her enough not to want to break her heart because of our relationship. And the same is true with God. We should fear breaking the heart of God. And what's interesting is that Jonah seems to fear God's authority, but not really fear breaking God's heart, because he's just running from him. Jonah knows that God has the authority to announce judgment, but Jonah actually doesn't really care so much about the relationship side of it. This is the type of Christianity that says, I just want to get out of jail free card. I want to make sure I don't go to hell when I die, but doesn't actually want to live for the glory of God, which isn't really Christianity, is it? Christianity is not just fire insurance later. It's a fully orbed life in the spirit that involves the abundant life now and the abundant life in the hereafter. But Jonah, I fear the Lord. It's my God who did this. Now look at what happens next. Because in verse 10, it says, Then the men were exceedingly afraid, and they said to him, why have you done this? For the men knew that he fled from the presence of the Lord because he had told them. Then they said to him, what shall we do to you that the sea may be calm for us? For the sea was growing more tempestuous. And he said to them, pick me up and throw me into the sea, then the sea will be calm for you. Now I know that this great tempest is because of me. Nevertheless, verse 13, the men rowed hard to return to land, but they could not, for the sea continued to grow more tempestuous against them. Now you see what's going on now. Jonah says, I fear the Lord, and now these guys are exceedingly afraid. Now they realize, look, we have a really major problem here. Not only has Jonah's rebellion impacted them, now there are consequences. Because now they're like really freaked out. Well, what should we do? And Jonah's like, I want you to throw me into the sea. Jonah's saying, look, I want you to give me over. Give me back to my God. Give me back. And notice what these guys do. They don't do it. They're rowing harder trying to get to shore. Why? Because these guys, they don't want on their conscience that they killed the prophet of the true and living God. What does this teach us? My friends, sin has consequences. Not only does our rebellion impact other people, sin, that's a biblical word which means missing the mark, missing out on who we're supposed to be, that has consequences. Now, these boat dudes, now they have to deal with, oh, okay, so in order to stop the storm, Jonah needs to go in. But now I'm going to have to live the rest of my life thinking I killed this prophet on this boat. Stinks for them, right? And Jonah's like, look, because I did this, now I need to go in the ocean. I need to go in. My friends, the reason God calls a sin, the reason he says don't sin is because God loves you enough not to want to see you hurt yourself and hurt other people. That's God's heart. God is not a big meanie who says, listen, I don't want you to have any fun because I'm kind of grumpy and crusty and I don't want you to have any fun in life. He's saying, no, I love you so much, I don't want you to hurt yourselves. And God knows that we are so short-sighted that we are willing to hurt ourselves for a moment of illicit pleasure. He knows that. And so God is a good God who loves us and says, look, I love you too much to want you to hurt yourselves, so don't hurt yourselves. But if we choose to hurt ourselves, it hurts. Because sin has consequences, my friends. And notice, it's not only consequences for Jonah, because Jonah literally believes he is dying. But now these poor boat dudes, I mean, can you imagine? They didn't do anything wrong. They were just doing their job, being the dudes of the boat. The guy took the fare, he goes, and now they realize, we're going to have this on our conscience for the rest of our lives. And if this guy is a prophet of the true and living God and he's fleeing from God's presence and he can't do that, I'm going to have to live the rest of my life this way, knowing I killed the prophet of the Lord. Poor guys. Because sin has consequences all around. But no matter what these boat guys do, they could not get Jonah to the shore. So look at what happens in verse 14. Therefore, they cried out to the Lord and said, "We pray, O Lord, please do not let us perish for this man's life, and do not charge us with innocent blood, for you, O Lord, have done as it pleased you." So they picked up Jonah and threw him into the sea, and the sea ceased from its raging. Then the men feared the Lord exceedingly and offered a sacrifice to the Lord and took vows. Verse 17, now the Lord had prepared a great fish to swallow Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights. Now, as I invite the worship team to come on out to help me finish this out, what we learn here is that God's ways are rebellious. God's ways are rebellious. The reason God's ways are rebellious is because God's works are redemptive. God's ways are rebellious because God's works are redemptive. Notice what happens here. Look at what happens. The first thing you get in verse 14, now they cried out to the Lord. You notice in your Bible, before they called him God, that was a general type of a word, God, which literally meant the God who created everything. Now they're crying out to the Lord, capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D. That's Yahweh or Jehovah. That's God's personal name. The God who made a covenant with the children of Israel and kept it. The God who sent his son Jesus to die on a cross and to rise again. Now you get pagans praying. For these men, the boat dudes, probably the first time in their lives, because of this situation, they are praying to the Lord, the true and living God. And they say, Lord, please do not hold this man's life against us. They're like, look, we're going to throw this guy into the sea. He's your prophet. Please don't charge it against us because this is pleasing to you. This is what we're supposed to do. So it begins with pagans praying. Then in verse 15, look at what happens. It says, so they picked up Jonah and they threw him into the sea, and the sea ceased from its raging. Right as Jonah landed in the ocean, all of it stopped. Now, you're going to find out next week as a little bit of a teaser that God's plan is not to kill Jonah. God's plan is to accomplish the mission. But Jonah's going into the water is the cure for the storm. This is not normal, my friends. Not normal. But God is doing a redemptive work. Now notice what happens in verse 16. This thing continues to roll. Then the men feared the Lord exceedingly and offered a sacrifice to the Lord and took vows. So the boat dudes go from praying to the Lord for the first time. Now their worship is starting to deepen. Jonah lands in the water. All the storm stops. And these men are now exceedingly fearing the Lord, which is the beginning of wisdom and is the beginning of knowledge. And they begin to offer sacrifices to the Lord. Why? Because the sacrifice means, Lord, this stuff is not my source, you're my source. These things that we live on is not what sustains us, but you sustain us. And they begin to offer sacrifices to the Lord and they take vows. God's ways are so rebellious because now these boat dudes are worshiping the true and living God, not just praying to him as any other God, but they're saying, look, we are gonna worship you with the offering of sacrifice, the sacrifice of praise and of the things that sustain my life. And then verse 17, now the Lord had prepared a great fish to swallow Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights. Now, I'm going to speak about this more next week. But notice, who prepared a fish? The Lord did. Now, I know some of you who are bent on skepticism. You're going to say, psh. I mean, how can you believe that? Now listen, first notice, the Lord prepared a special fish for Jonah. If you get eaten by a fish, I don't expect you to last 3 days and three nights. Okay? Like if you get eaten by a fish, that's the end of it. Right? But God prepared a fish. A specific fish. Now, for those of you who are skeptical, you can't wait till next week because you might not come back because we believe this stuff. This is what I want to tell you real quick. You ever hear of a submarine? It kind of looks like a fish, right? It can go under the water, not just for 3 days and three nights, but for hundreds of days. And not just one guy, but lots of people, right? Now, track with me. If God created man, and man could figure out how to submerge people in water for hundreds of days, lots of people, and they not die, you don't think the God who created them could figure that out first? If men can figure it out, and if there is a God, and I'm telling you that there is, if men can figure it out, then God already knew how to do it. So don't believe, oh, I can't believe. Yes, you can. Yes, you can. Philosophers call that an argument from the lesser to the greater. If men can figure out, and if God created man, then God already knew how to do it. And God didn't need the metal and the defense contracts and all those things to get it done either. He just called up a fish, did whatever he did, and said, here you go. And it sustained Jonah for 3 days and three nights. But we'll talk about that more next week, just to get you excited. But listen, my friends, everything about this is God being rebellious. Why? Because God is not willing that any should perish. Not the Ninevites, not ISIS rebels. And God's rebellious because his work is radically redemptive. And God's design is to save and to forgive. And I believe for many of us today, for some of us, you need to put your faith and trust in the Lord, the God of creation, the true and living God who has control over everything, because you've been running from that God your whole life. And I'm going to give you an opportunity to do that in just one moment after we pray. Make that decision. For others of you, you're like Jonah. You believe in the Lord, but you're running. God has a call on your life, and you're like, I'm out of here. You're heading in the exact opposite direction. And if that's you, my encouragement is to stop running, but simply return home. Let's bow our heads and our hearts as we pray.